The Holy Gospel according to John, the 13th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already put it into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You do not know now what I am doing, but later you will understand." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "One who has bathed does not need to wash, except for the feet, but is entirely clean. And you are clean, though not all of you. For he knew who was to betray him. For this reason he said, "Not all of you are clean." After Jesus had washed their feet, had put on his robe, and had returned to the table, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example, that you also should do as I have done to you. Very truly I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them. Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
So I know I have told you this story before, but it's been a while, and when has that ever stopped me before? So a few years back, a scientist came up with an experiment. He wanted to get a sense of just how much influence our expectations that we have for something actually have on that something. So he began where any one of us would begin, with rats. Okay, he went and he purchased a whole bunch of rats and split them in half. Not the rats, he put them into two groups, is what I'm... In this totally random fashion, he put half of the rats into one cage and the other half of the rats into this other cage. And on the first cage, he hung a sign that read, "The rats in this cage are smarter than average." And on the other cage, he hung a sign that said, "The rats in this cage are dumber than average." And then he invited a group of researchers to come in and perform some of their own experiments with these rats, all while not knowing that these signs on the cages were totally made up. When the researchers turned in the results of those experiments that they performed, the scientist was stunned. The group of rats that were in the cage marked as smarter literally performed all the tests twice as well as the group of rats that were in the cage marked dumber. Again, the only difference was the sign that had been made up and hung on their cage. These results kind of determined that, yes, humans can indeed influence our actions just out because of the expectations that we have. What I think that translates to for us is that if we have certain expectations, they can become true in us. I mean, think about it. If we tell ourselves that there's no way we can do something, we are probably not going to be able to do that something, even if we are perfectly capable of doing that something. Or if we tell ourselves enough times that we are nothing but a worthless piece of trash, we are going to start believing that we indeed are a worthless piece of trash. If our expectations for ourselves is that we can't do anything right ever, it won't be long until we completely believe that we can't do anything right ever. Does that make sense? I mean, have you experienced this phenomenon in yourself? Are there expectations that you've had for yourself that have come true because you've convinced yourself of them? I mean, obviously, it doesn't take a whole lot of influence because in that experiment, it was just these signs that were hung on the cages that the researchers believed and influenced these rats to perform in that way. Which leads me to yet another story that I know I talked about in a totally different sermon quite a while ago, but it was something I heard called power poses. And this idea came from this psychologist who was teaching her listeners about those things you do to instill confidence within yourself or to change your mood or behavior. So one power pose, and I remember us practicing these, pulling your shoulders back and raising your chin and putting your hands on your hips. You remember that? Think how powerful this feels when you do that. Another pose we did was to put one or both fists in the air. This is confident, right? The psychologist said that if you do one of those poses for like 2 minutes, you actually change how you feel. You know, think about if you're going into an important interview or an important meeting, instead of waiting and sitting in the waiting room and just hunched over with your legs crossed, take a couple minutes and go to the restroom and look at yourself in the mirror and make one of those power poses and ignore everyone around you that's looking at you, and you're going to change the way that you present yourself when you go into that meeting. Does that make sense? Have you done that? If this does in fact work, that means that you have the ability, truly have the ability, to influence how you feel and how you perceive yourself and how you present yourself. Think about this, or try this. The next time you find yourself in a bad mood, go look in a mirror, look right at yourself, and smile. Have you ever done that? I'm going to bet that your mood will change, even just a little bit, very quickly. Both positively and negatively, it has been shown, and I bet that most of us have probably experienced this ourselves, that we absolutely can influence what we believe about ourselves. Which gets us to tonight. Maundy Thursday is the first of these great 3 days, as they're often called. 3 days that lead us from Jesus' suffering and death to his resurrection and new life. And tonight is the prelude of that, where we start. Tonight is about those things that Jesus wants to leave with us before he walks off into his death. You know, this is that moment where someone might say, any last words? At the end of his earthly ministry. And the first thing he wants to leave us with that we experience tonight is this understanding of forgiveness. Each and every year on Maundy Thursday, the very first thing that we do at the start of the service is confess our sins and hear a pronouncement of forgiveness. And I know, yes, we generally do a confession and forgiveness at the start of every worship service when we gather almost every week. But tonight, We want to drive the point home so much that not only do we do this as a group together, corporately, but then we also invite you up individually so that I, on behalf of God, can tell each one of you directly that your sins are forgiven. And maybe I should say it again. Your sins are forgiven. Maybe if we keep telling ourselves that or keep hearing those words said to us, we might start to actually believe them. And I mean deeply believe them. Because when we begin to deeply believe that we are forgiven, we can begin to live in a whole new way. In a way that is not burdened by the guilt of sin or shame. I mean, do you believe that that is who you are in the sight of God? Do you? I hope so. I can sense the enthusiasm about it. The other thing that Jesus wants to leave us with before he walks on to Friday is this understanding that we are loved. Just as I have loved you, says Jesus, you also should love one another. For one thing, this is the night that we remember Jesus' Last Supper that he shares with his disciples, where he breaks the bread and he passes the cup, all in an act that calls us to do the same, in remembrance of me, in remembrance of Jesus. You know, sharing a meal is indeed an act of love in and of itself, but add on to that the significance of Jesus' parting words on this night, and we see the love in this meal flow even deeper. And then we hear this story in John's Gospel, where before they even started eating, Jesus gets up from the table, removes his robe, and ties this towel around his waist. He bends down and begins to wash the disciples' feet. An act of humbleness, an act of service, an act of love. When we talked about washing feet with the kids right before the service started, you should have seen the looks on their faces. My feet? Ugh! That is love. Because it takes a lot of love to wash someone's feet, doesn't it? Actually, in those days, what it actually took was power to make someone else wash your feet. Because normally it was the slaves who would be washing the feet of their masters. But again, Jesus turns that understanding on its head, and he shows his power through his service and through his loving care for his disciples. Could you imagine being in that experience? I mean, just for Jesus to just say, "I love you," wasn't enough for him. It wasn't enough to get it through their heads. Jesus had to show it. So again, tonight tells us over and over and over and over again that God loves us. Did you hear that? God loves us. Can we convince ourselves of that and be changed by it? God loves us. Imagine how we would treat ourselves if we put this sign around our neck so that every time we looked at it and we looked at ourselves, we would see those words looking back at us. I am loved. How much would that change how you lived each day? Imagine then if we saw every person around us with a sign around their neck that said, "Loved child of God." Would that change how you treated them? Because we did hear Jesus say, "I have set you an example that you also should do as I have done to you." Which means love and service to our neighbor. And so then would the way that we treat them change the way that they think about themselves? And if they treated that, and if we're treated that same way by others, would that change how we think about ourselves? I mean, you see how this works, don't you? This whole thing begins to spiral and works together to create a giant love fest, which is exactly what God intends for this world, for us to live as though we are truly and deeply loved, and to treat one another as though we are all truly and deeply loved. I mean, these were Jesus' parting words to his disciples and to us. So can we let that night truly influence who we are in this world as loved children of God? I hope so. Amen.